thank you all for staying to the last session this evening, and thank you, of course, to everybody at Nuqat for giving me the opportunity to speak with you today on this topic on back to the city, restoring and sustaining creativity in the urban landscape. Of course, those of you who are familiar with my work, this comes as no surprise to you that this would be my intervention here today. As some of you may know, I recently published a book published by Stanford University Press called Kuwait Transformed, A History of Oil and Urban Life. And in my book, I analyzed the transformation of the city, of Kuwait City, the built environment, in the shift from the pre-oil to oil periods, and analyzing the impact that that transformation to the city had on our everyday life and social relations and dynamics in Kuwait. So it's really an analysis of Kuwaiti society and everyday life through the lens of the city and the built environment. And my ultimate argument is really that all of the changes that occurred in the city after the advent of oil urbanization in 1950, that it had a negative effect on our society and our social relations. I analyze how certain aspects of urban development has made us more segregated, more divisive, in some ways less tolerant of others, and so on. And I also argue that the planning paradigm that we adopted in 1950 is no longer sustainable, spatially sustainable in terms of the city itself and also socially sustainable, which is why I think in the kind of discussion we're having here today, where we're sort of recognizing that the oil resource dependency is no longer sustainable in the long term in Kuwait, and discussing this idea of powering a creative economy, I think it's important for us to discuss then the role of the city in fostering and nurturing a creative economy. So as a historian, I'd like to just start with a brief, very brief background, historical background on the city. This will probably be familiar to many of you. But with the advent of oil urbanization, which began in 1950, so about 4 years after the first barrels of oil were exported, Kuwait embarked on a modernization scheme that involved two main sort of arms. One was the advent or the creation of a cradle-to-grave welfare system, so free, state-funded access to education, healthcare, housing, employment, and so on. And part of that process was the launch of an urban development process, an era of master planning, and the production of a new city to replace the old pre-oil port town that was there prior to 1950. And this new era of master planning brought in a few key features that are important for our discussion today. One was functional zoning, creating zones around the city. So the city center itself being sort of stripped and demolished and stripped of all residential space, residential spaces being put out into, here's some of the images of the early oil period. Residential spaces being moved out into the suburbs. The city center itself was transformed into a financial and bureaucratic city. You had new spaces for industry in Shuikh, in healthcare in the Sabah Hospital area, which you can sort of see out here. Commercial activities mostly moved out of the city center and so on. Also part of this early oil modernization was, of course, suburbanization, so the movement of residential areas out of the city center. And with this came a substantial amount of socio-spatial segregation, so the moving of the population into neighborhoods that were largely, especially in the early periods, based on background. So you had neighborhoods for the old city residents. You had different neighborhoods for the newly sedentarizing Bedouin. You had different areas for Kuwaitis and non-Kuwaitis, and so on. And then finally, we had the advent of economic and cultural privatization of public spaces. So the creation of more privatized indoor commercial complexes, private beach clubs, and so on. So life became increasingly privatized and also increasingly separated and segmented out into different spheres. So, people went to work in the city center, spent their leisure time on the coast, went shopping in Salmiya, and then went home to rest in the suburbs, and of course to this day, and we do this mostly moving around by private car. So in many ways, cityscapes like this, like Kuwait's, that are highly planned and developed are quite stifling to creativity. Now before I elaborate on that first, what do I mean here by creativity? Now of course, in the modern world, in this context, we largely tend to think of creativity like we've been speaking today in relation to the visual arts, theater, music, literature, architecture, or of course also, the making of innovative things, innovative products or services that can be bought and sold. But I'd also like to extend this idea of creativity to include social activities involved in inventing and reinventing ourselves, inventing new ways of living that are more interesting, that are more enriching, more fulfilling to us as human beings. So beyond just the creative arts or industries, but different ways, creative ways that we come up with as humans to reinvent ourselves and our everyday lives. So when we talk about this idea of creating new ways of living and being in the world, in a city like Kuwait or a country like Kuwait that is very heavily urbanized, we need to think of the role in the city, of the city in that context. So to go back, why, you know, I mentioned earlier, why are highly developed modern cities then largely stifling to creativity? So to elaborate on this, you know, if we look at cities that were planned in this sort of modernist paradigm, largely after World War II, if we're looking in predominantly in Europe and North America, and then this model was spread over the entire world, including Kuwait, this kind of modernist planning's emphasis was really on the creation of rational, orderly cities. There was this belief that architecture and urban planning and the planning of the production of well-planned urban landscapes could create a new social order, could regulate public behavior by weeding out and removing disorder and creating a more disciplined and predictable, but also ideally a more egalitarian society. So the premise of modernist planning was to create a new social order. And of course, modernist planning also tended to focus heavily on economic and commercial development of urban cores, what we tend to call central business districts. So again, with zoning, functional zoning, suburbanization, and so on. And of course, on cars and highways. That was a major aspect of modernist planning, more emphasis on car travel and less on pedestrianization. So then what impact does this planning have on society and on creativity? So in heavily planned and zoned cities that are, again, ones that are dependent on car travel, people lose the chance to engage and interact with difference. So confronting or encountering, interacting, negotiating new people, new ideas, new ways of living in a shared urban landscape. So with zoning, with functional zoning, there's little chance for spontaneous, the unpredictable, the new, you know, all of which, these are all, of course, key factors in fostering creativity. If you're only exposed to the same people or to the same way of life, or if you spend your day in separate spheres of activity and you're not encountering much diversity, this has a very deadening effect on our creative capacity. And so as an example, I'll give you a quote from a study on Paris, which of course, as we know, for centuries, Paris has been thought of as the cultural or creative capital of the world. But by the 1970s, and these are both images of Paris, there was, and after a period of major urban modernist planning, there was a decline of cultural activity and urban creativity due to, quote, difficulties of moving about and exchanging ideas in the car-clogged city. Creativity also suffered as core districts went heavily over to office space. The city's population increasingly comprised executives and professionals, which accounted for much of the reduced social and cultural vitality, end quote. That's from a book by Charles Rurik on Paris. So that was Paris, but what about Kuwait? So we have the first analysis of the impact, the social impact of oil urbanization that was written in an article in 1964, by Fakhri Shahab, who was the economic advisor to Abdullah Salem. And he's not speaking here directly about the impact of urban planning, but it gives us a good idea about how modernization was changing Kuwaiti society. So, quote, young people have lost their perspective, their urge to acquire knowledge, their acceptance of discipline. As a result, the drive, diligence, and risk-taking that has characterized the old Kuwaiti are no more. At both ends of the social scale, the new citizen is content to enjoy a life of leisure and inertia, and is unwilling that this happy state of affairs should be disturbed. Protected, pampered, lavishly provided for, and accountable to no one, he lives in a world of make-believe, end quote. So that's 1964. So what he's saying here is that cradle-to-grave welfare, coupled, I would argue, with the planned development of a new city that privileged private life over public belonging, drained Kuwaitis of the creative energy that had animated economic and cultural life before oil. So for instance, in business, you know, and he was mainly looking here at the economic effects. In business, you know, he talks about Kuwaiti merchants before oil, the creative, and Fatma had mentioned this in the panel earlier today, the creativity that went into Kuwaiti merchants in their trades, also shipbuilders, the local industries, and so on. And what Chab looks at is, you know, how after oil, it became much easier just to import cars or other commodities, to open franchises, rather than, for instance, developing new local industries aside from the oil industry or opening local businesses. And again, as we heard earlier, although the fine arts and theater and so on were flourishing in Kuwait in the 60s and those early oil decades, the ease with which wealth could now be acquired had stamped out innovation and imagination in all other sectors, including eventually in the arts, as we were sort of talking about today. The vibrancy of the art scene in the Gulf in the early oil decades was stimulated by the excitement, the changes, the newness. Once that just started to become the norm, we see a decline in the arts as well. Now, of course, fast forward to today, 50 years later, Shahab's observations no longer hold true. They're losing ground. Young people today are becoming restless, no longer content to simply be, as he puts it, protected, pampered, and lavishly provided for. So new businesses are germinating, and new ideas are germinating and spreading rapidly, not only in the creative arts, in the visual arts and so on, but also in business, in technology, in industry, in food, and in the creation, as I said earlier, of new ways of living that are more enriching, interesting, and fulfilling. Think of a space like, or an idea like the Secret Garden in Salmiya. And it's also no coincidence that a lot of these young entrepreneurs, artists, architects, chefs, intellectuals, activists, and so on, who are steering Kuwait's budding creative economy today, are magnetically drawn back to the city center after decades of life in the suburbs or in privatized shopping malls. The city and the city center really allows for much more engagement with diverse people and activities than our segregated neighborhoods or our shopping malls. So if, as I argued earlier, modern planning and development played a role in stifling creativity, then how can the city help reverse this process and foster or nurture creativity? Now, since around the 1980s around the world, there's been a growing realization in cities about the importance of the creative or culture industries in promoting urban growth and sustainability and revitalizing, you know, increasingly dead, decaying, or simply boring central business districts. So things like building museums, cultural centers, and so on, not just offices or commercial developments or government spaces, etc. And of course, we see this happening in Kuwait too, with the opening of the new, with the cultural center we're standing in today, the new cultural center next door, and so on. But while we can see how culture industries are bolstering cities and urban economies by bringing new life into decaying urban centers, so I keep forgetting to switch my slides, this process is not always very democratic. This kind of sort of culture-driven planning entails the production of large-scale, often state-led projects like the Centre Pompidou in Paris, the Tate Modern in London, and so on, that stimulates the same kind of top-down, elite-driven urban development that we saw in the earlier stages of more commercial or capitalist-driven urban development. So basically, these cultural projects, these large-scale cultural projects that are meant to sort of revitalize the city, becomes part of the gentrifying process that do similar things as commercial development. So driving up the cost of real estate to the point that it becomes less and less affordable for people to afford, or in this case, to create in the city. So rather than focusing on what culture, you know, with a capital C, can do to enhance and reinvigorate the city, we should also ask the reverse. How can the city enhance and reinvigorate creativity? So not just how creative industries can revive urban centers, but how urban settings can be more conducive to promoting a thriving creative economy that goes beyond simply the creative industries that are housed in museums and large cultural centers and large galleries and so on. Now, one key component to creativity, as we heard earlier from Mr. Ali Lyohan, the discussion is freedom. And in the urban case, I would argue that this means freedom from over-planning, freedom from top-down control of urban space, and particularly cultural spaces in the city. So in order to foster, you know, for a creative economy to truly flourish, our city must be able to accommodate and sustain new ideas that fall outside the scope of official sponsorship, official state sponsorship or control, and are therefore also more affordable to more people. So we need basically more unplanned and unregulated spaces that encourage cultural experimentation and social exploration. And this requires a significant paradigm shift from the profit-driven, state-led development that, you know, Kuwait has followed for the past 65 years or so. Now, many of the young sort of entrepreneurs, designers, chefs, and so on that are driving Kuwait's budding creative economy, again, as I mentioned, are not only, you know, often pulled back to the city center, but also tend to be drawn to the less regulated, less zoned, less controlled, or less financially motivated spaces and interstices of the city. So for instance, there's the case of small businesses that have started moving back into the city since around 2005, it started off in this strip in front of Seif Palace, and we've seen this idea spread, and largely moving into older buildings in the city center rather than into new complexes, mainly because older buildings have cheaper rent, they have lower khulu or key money. And so this is, you know, the kind of urban space that helps to foster creativity. We also saw outside of the city, similarly, for instance, the creation of Arabana, which was a shared workspace for creatives and designers that was created in an old warehouse in industrial Shwech. So again, in sort of the less obvious, you know, hidden spaces of the urban landscape. And of course, we also see examples of urban spaces and the urban landscape being used to create new ways of living, again, that is more fulfilling or enriching. Again, that other kind of creativity that I mentioned earlier. So, for instance, the Secret Garden, the new initiative Basla, which use urban spaces, walls in the city, to raise awareness on humanitarian needs. So again, different creative ways that we can use the urban landscape in a more humane kind of way. But still, these kinds of initiatives face a lot of challenges in Kuwait and restrictions. So for instance, zoning laws. So Arabana on the left, one of the challenges they had to be able to open as a shared sort of office work design studio space is that there's no zoning for that in Shwech. Shwech is zoned as an industrial area. So that zoning being one of the sort of relics of the old planning paradigm, the modernist planning paradigm. Similarly, food markets, which as we know have become very popular in Kuwait, in which I see the food and industry and the markets which help to foster and sustain small businesses, home businesses, which again I think is key when we talk about a creative economy. These kinds of markets also are challenged by licensing laws in Kuwait. You can't use public land for commercial purposes, for these kinds of private commercial purposes. So again, licensing laws, these kinds of old relics from the earlier planning paradigm. And of course, we see public spaces and uncommodified community spaces like Beit Lodhan are increasingly being lost to commercial malls and that the kinds of places that elevate consumption to our principal mode of human interaction and our primary daily activity. You know, and consumption and these kinds of malls, you know, are encourage conformity and again are stifling to creativity. So these are the challenges that I think that we're facing in nurturing our creative economy. Now, as my final point, why does this matter? Why should the city be more accommodating and less regulating of all of these new kinds of creative initiatives? There is, of course, the economic impact. You know, as I mentioned, certain undeveloped spaces of the city or unplanned spaces of the city are more affordable to small businesses. And of course, small businesses are key even in Kuwait's sort of planning for, economic planning. And so we need more places or spaces like this that allow small businesses, restaurants, cafes, galleries, and so on to thrive. But also, a lot of these new homegrown small local initiatives have helped to pull or revitalize the city center over the last sort of decade in ways, and you know, I've studied Kuwait's urban history for about 200 years. Since the advent of oil, no initiative has really been as invigorating to the city center. No state-led or really high commercially led development has been as thriving for the city center as a lot of these more bottom-up or small-scale initiatives. But the economic advantages aside, and including the economic advantages to the city, there's also a social dimension, which is that these can help improve social relations in Kuwait, our social interactions. It has the potential to democratize urban space and, as I talked about earlier, increase social interactions between different groups, social contacts, social, you know, encounters with different ways of living, and which in turn breeds greater creativity and helps to create a more enriching everyday life for us all. And so, you know, arguably some of these kind, this greater interaction and this more creative approach to the city can help reverse some of the, what I argue in my book, to be some of the negative social effects of, you know, top-down city planning over the past 60 years. Now, as my final 5 seconds I see here, I'll leave you with this one quote from Ash Amin and Nigel Thrift in their book, Cities Reimagining the Urban, that the city, quote, offers a practical and material means of meeting social needs and more. It is a place of becoming and the fulfillment of social potential, of democratic experimentation through the efforts of citizens themselves. Thank you.
Hello, thank you. Hi. For your lecture. So you bring out a lot of great points, but one thing that I keep asking myself is, so you point out that there's a top-down planning approach that's kind of an elitist approach, but then you bring up the bottom-up mm-hmm. kind of grassroots movement, which I question, is that also elitist mm-hmm. in this society? So can you kind of...
Absolutely, and I do think that that is the case in many instances. I wouldn't say necessarily in all, but I a lot of these sort of initiatives are driven by a more elite sector of society. But I would say many aspects of the discussions that we're having here today, and in fact, probably when we do talk about the creation of a creative economy, especially in the early stages, it probably is going to be more elite-driven. Because, you know, those who are more financially capable of, you know, working in a creative field and not having to worry immediately about the paycheck at the end, sort of like what we were talking about earlier. So I agree with you in that. And I do think, I mean, in my book, I do look at, when we're looking at less from this sort of creative economic perspective, but a lot more from the sociological perspective that I talk about, that, you know, I can see different effects from some of these, you know, and I look at sort of some of the more business-oriented approaches are gentrifying. You know, they do the same kinds of effect as gentrification does. And in Kuwait's particular context, I see in some projects in the city center, these businesses and so on, a sort of tension between reclaiming the city as turf, Kuwaitizing the city, you know? And I warn against that, because that to me, you know, is just doing more of the same thing. Whereas I'm arguing that we need more freedom to be able to create spaces of interaction. You know, spaces, I would argue, more like the secret garden, which is more democratizing. There's no particular control, it's volunteer-based, and it's very mixed when you look at sort of the makeup of the volunteers and those. So, I mean, I definitely see, though, what your point, and I would agree with you.
Sure. Thanks, Farah, for...
Oh, here.
Yeah, sorry. Thanks for the lecture, and it's interesting that you bring up these two examples, the secret garden and Beit Lodan. Mm. Both examples have been demolished recently.
Yeah.
And so the question that kind of really posits itself is, what is it that seems so threatening about these institutions? Is it some sort of, it's clearly an attempt to reclaim the city, and it's an attempt to kind of understand gain a better understanding of the urban through these interventions. But so this is also another kind of divergent path. Since Gulf cities are so, they're city states essentially, mm-hmm. is it that governments fear a reclamation to the city? This is also my interpretation, since you are thus kind of giving a democratization mechanism to the citizens, as opposed to the top-down kind of governmental planning initiatives. And so, again, this is just my interpretation and a reaction almost to what we currently see.
Absolutely. I think there's two ways of approaching this. I think one, when you look at, for instance, a case like Beit Lothan, there are very, that's, you know, we're dealing with, those are more capitalist sort of commercial driven processes, you know, that these are, this is very, very expensive land, high value land, and so, you know, it might be nice for us to think, oh, let's keep it for these community kinds of spaces, but when you're looking at it from the perspective of the landowner or the developer, they have a very different idea in mind. So there's that. That, you know, the value, the cost of land in Kuwait, which is exorbitantly high, and those kinds of factors that I would say is the biggest risk to a lot of the kinds of spaces that I'm referring to here. But I think from the other perspective, you know, for instance, you brought up the demolition of the Secret Garden a few weeks ago. I think there it's more a matter of this is very new for Kuwait. You know, as I mentioned, we've been living under the same planning paradigm for the past six decades or more. And so the idea of these community-based spaces and the value of these community-based spaces and the feeling that a lot of people get from them, even in ways that people don't really tend to know how to articulate or what it is, there's just something special going on in some of these kinds of spaces, and there's others in the city and so on. I think it's very new. So that whole idea of taking, you know, a place, you know, a piece of the landscape that has, and the city has always come under the purview of the state and of state institutions or private developers. But this is a new gray area. It's not the private sector. It's not, you know, that it's this new space in between. And I think that it's just a matter of getting used to it. But this is why I think it's important for us to draw attention to this, that it's not threatening. You know what I mean? These are not spaces that should be seen as in any way threatening or, you know, or challenging. They're challenging the status quo, but in a way that recognizes that the status quo is no longer working for us in many ways. So I don't know if that really answers, yeah.
Okay. Hi. A great lecture. Thank you very much. And thank you for Kuwait Transformed. I think it's very informative.
Thank you.
My question is, or comment, I don't know what you call it. You started with modernity being discipline, explaining modernity as discipline. Can we say then that creativity is paradoxical to discipline? In the sense of, like, most of the images that you showed, this kind of the creative images or creative spaces, are kind of chaotic. In the don't get me wrong, I mean, they're beautifully chaotic.
Right.
Can we say that creativity is the opposite of discipline and modernity?
I wouldn't necessarily say it's the opposite, but I think creativity needs a certain amount of disorder, you know? And I think society, by extension, needs disorder to really be, you know, to really be engaging, to really, you know, you know, with the advent of modernist planning and thinking, we tend to think of disorderly places or disorderly things, you know, as somehow negative. But I think, you know, disorder tends to breed very particular kinds of social relations and, I think, creativity. So I would say, you know, what you use the term chaotic, I think when places are not perfectly orderly and sanitized, then definitely I think they're more conducive, let's say, to creativity than... I don't know if I would say it's the opposite because that's too sort of causal, but I would say definitely more conducive to creativity.
Hi. thank you for your talk. I'm actually just following up with what Enes was saying because I see that this idea of having a space that is not organized by the state as being a place for not for chaos to start or for I don't agree with this the idea that like chaotic is kind of equivalent to the creative or
no,
so
yeah.
But I think that having an unplanned space, allowing for the creative to create their own program, so to actually initiate a program that suits the demands of the public.
Exactly.
So the creative, not as, I don't see it as the creative as elites or not. I think it's just this, these people who are able to create a curriculum or a program that starts something, that it's like an initiation of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I don't think it's relevant to being disorganized or so. It's just this kind of place that is left to the choice of the public.
Right. And I wouldn't necessarily use the terms chaotic nor disorganized, actually, in this. And I would, that's why I emphasize sort of more disorder, disorderly being the opposite of orderly. When we think, especially with regard to planning, when we think of orderly spaces, what is inherently meant is controlled. And controlled in that somebody is doing the planning, somebody is doing the orderling. Disorderly, so doesn't necessarily mean it's just all chaotic and a mess. Disorderly means it's not prey to that sort of logic of rational, you know, rational, disciplined space. And that's what I would mean, more than the idea of just a messy, disorganized, you know, chaos. And in that sense, then I think when we look at this from the perspective of orderly, controlled, and planned, then what you're talking about comes out, because what we mean then in this more disorderly space is that they're unplanned spaces where people then have the freedom to explore different ideas, and I think, you know, Medina is a perfect example, to put you on the spot, but Medina is a perfect example of this kind of very, very creative output from the urban landscape, and particularly focusing on the less sort of, you know, the sort of the interstices, the alternative views of the city, you know. And so, yeah, I mean, I would agree with that.
Hi.
I personally think that the city is defined by its youth, and unfortunately, I do feel that Kuwait City is not a very youthful city. So if you go to any major city in the world, I mean, if you walk the streets or whatever, you see the youth walking the street. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, working in the shops or working in some of the institutions or be it offices. So the city is pretty much defined by its youth. Whereas here in Kuwait, unfortunately, due to tradition and of course the way that we lead our lifestyles, is that we cannot actually leave our houses until we are married or leaving the country. So we don't really reside in the city. So there isn't like this whole concept and idea of this like live workspace in order to work in the city and make the city thrive. So what are your thoughts on that?
I agree with you. And actually, you know, the example from Paris, and that was one of the things as well. So not only was the city largely occupied by executives, that there was a lack of youth in the city too. That was one of the arguments that the author was also making later on. But so I would agree, and this is why I think a lot of these new initiatives that are occurring in the city are drawing not only those who are creating these spaces or these ideas in the city, but also so those who, it's made the city more interesting, it's made the city more desirable. We haven't thought collectively about Kuwait City as the city center as a place of becoming some in a long time. In Kuwait's sort of post-oil urban history. And that's why I think, so even, Mira, to go back to the point that you made, so some of these places and spaces might be sort of elite-driven, so they might have a similar gentrifying effect, but the fact is they are bringing young people in particular out of the suburbs, out of the malls, and into the city. And yes, those still might be, especially when we look at who goes to the restaurants and cafes and so on in the city, still might be at a more sort of certain class level. But in fact, it's bringing precisely the kinds of people back into the city who I think most need to get out of that privatized world that we've built, which are more the elite classes in Kuwait, to expose them to everything that the city has to offer, which are, you know, the dynamic hidden spaces where different classes, people of different backgrounds use and thrive in. And so I think it's important for people to see those kinds of spaces. And I think it's generating a lot of interest. So hopefully what we're on to then is, it's exactly why I actually wanted to focus on this topic. because when we're talking about our creative economy, we're largely talking about youth-driven initiatives. There's the city. We can't ignore the city then. You know, there's a lot of benefit for both. And living. But I think that's the next step. Increasingly, I now hear people saying, I would love to live in the city center. I would love to be able to walk or ride my bike or go to Mbarki and buy my grocery, my vegetables and so on from the market. There is a growing interest in that, I think. It'll take time, but I think it's coming.
Just thanking you for the book, really a treasure that you have created for us in terms of revisiting our history. I'm just curious in terms of now some of the projects that you've mentioned with like the Secret Garden and then just these terms that have been thrown around as like chaos versus orderly or things like that and these projects either being demolished or having to, unfortunately, because like if they need to be existing, it has to be in somewhat of an illegal manner or like mm-hmm. a pop-up thing, sort mm-hmm. of like Shakshuka Market and those mm-hmm. types of areas. I'm just curious to know of, let's say your point of view or any thoughts you might have in terms of this new, relatively new sort of the Ministry of State for Youth Affairs, mm-hmm. if you see any type of role where these two aspects of yeah. our community can work together, for example.
Absolutely, and I think that that's very important. I think it's, you know, there's a risk of looking, because of what you said, because, you know, they sort of have to function in this sort of gray area, illegal realm. A lot of business, a lot of organized things that are unlicensed, you know, home businesses, it's all in this legal gray area. It's very risky to therefore look at this as a possible contention between these sort of individual initiatives or projects and the state. I think, you know, we don't want to go get to that point where it just becomes a contestation, you know, between the Secret Garden builds up, the municipality comes and demolishes. They build it back up and that. I think it's important then for there to be a more of a sense of cooperation and a dialogue between, okay, this is what is needed, and that is happening. You know, there's a lot of discussion on, for instance, licensing home businesses and things like that. So there is a discussion, but again, this is very new for Kuwait, so I think it's going to take time. But I definitely think greater collaboration with state institutions that are in, you know, that are involved in these kinds of, directly or indirectly. And the Ministry of Youth, I think, is definitely a place that can help to bring also a lot of these initiatives together. So I definitely think there's potential, but again, it's new, we're sort of experimenting here, and I think part of the problem is also we, as people, as citizens, meaning urban citizens, I always use the phrase, so Kuwaiti or non-Kuwaiti, but people who live in the city, we don't always know what the regulations are. We don't know the process enough. It's very opaque. So if we're going to start to take the lead in some of these projects and initiatives, we need to know how the system works in order to do it better. And I think there's a gap there in our education, our knowledge of how, you know, the state apparatus vis-a-vis the city and businesses and so on works. And so that's, I think, the next step, maybe. Thank you.